It is the 10 o'clock hour, Tuesday, May 10th, 2016. The Board of Supervisors of the County of Del Norte and the governing body of all other special assessment and taxing district for which said board so acts is now meeting in regular session. Only those items that indicate a specific time will be heard at the assigned time. All other items may be taken out of sequence to accommodate the public and staff availability. We are going to take some time now for a moment of reflection. And if you will now please stand, Supervisor Finnegan will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Introduction of new employees. Do we have any? No new employees. Any actions from closed session, County Council?
No reportable items.
Okay. At this time, I would request any deletions, corrections, or additions from board members. In order to add an item to the agenda, the matter must have come to the attention of the county subsequent to the posting of the agenda, and the matter requires action before the next regular meeting of the Board of Supervisors. Are there any such items? Okay, moving on. We will receive brief reports or announcements now from supervisors on programs, projects, progress, two-by-two committees, whatever we've been doing for the last couple of weeks. So we're going to start with Supervisor Gitlin.
Thank you, Chairman Hermanson. Well, it's election year. You can feel it, the buzz in the air, no question about it. The days seem to fly by quickly, and you can hardly believe it. It's last week we met April 28th at the Mary Peacock School. That was the triplicate True North candidates forum. All nine of those seeking candidates positions on the Board of Supervisors were on hand, and hopefully the audience got a pretty good idea of who each of us are. I followed up with my own community town hall the following Wednesday. That was held at the fairgrounds, the Arts and Crafts Room, and on hand there was Sheriff Apperson, Chief Minsel, D.A. Trigg, and Commander Mike Berry of the Highway Patrol to address one of the subjects we had on the agenda, which was crime in our community. How can we protect ourselves? And those on hand heard some really good suggestions, and again, there's no question about it, we're all impacted by this Prop 47 and AB 109 and how it makes our community more vulnerable to crime, and the law enforcement officers who were there representing their department spoke very articulately on that. The Chamber of Commerce hosted its annual economic summit. It was a particularly interesting presentation from a gentleman by the name of Keith Christensen. He's the program director for the Northern California I think it's the Procurement Center, on how small businesses can conduct a very lucrative business with the federal government, which buys all kinds of goods and all kinds of services. So if you want more information on how to do business with Uncle Sam, I recommend you give the Chamber of Commerce a call, and they'll put you in touch with Mr. Christensen and his program. And also there was a report, a very glowing report from the Del Norte Association of Realtors, 10% growth in the real estate market for Del Norte County in the past year, all good news. Attended the bi-monthly meeting a few days ago of the Area Operations Group, updated those in attendance on the status of our mutual aid agreements, and keeping all in the audience on the emergency status of where we stand in Del Norte County. Last Thursday, I sat on a monthly meeting of the Healthcare District with where a strategic positioning scoping document was discussed by the trustees, and buttoning down the details of conducting an independent study assessing the medical needs that are currently in place to serve Delmar County. The applicant to conduct this disinterested third-party assessment is a group called Quorum Healthcare Advisory Services. The healthcare district will be hosting a special meeting a little bit later this month to take action on whether it will hire Quorum. I think it's somewhere in the neighborhood of $75,000 to $85,000 to conduct this study. Also, I met in our mental health board meets once a month, and we have it's an all-too-short meeting. It's just an hour, and should be more, to discuss again how to spend the Prop 63 monies. It's about $416,000 to help those who have mental health challenges and how we can get them out of the bushes. It's very frustrating because law is so convoluted, it's restrictive, so we're moving toward what's called this special needs housing program, which makes it a little bit more flexible, because the bottom line is these people need help. They're living in our bushes, and we need to get them help one at a time. And I was particularly impressed that the next day we met on KFUG radio, and Sheriff Apperson announced his one-man task force. I think it's Deputy Pettis who will be going out looking for those in need, and if they don't have an assessment, we'll put them in touch with DHHSS to get an assessment so we can get folks help one at a time, two at a time, four at a time, eight, whatever we can get people out of the bushes. And that was the discussion we took place on KFUG. Also, Jerry Johnson, who is the commander of Post 1381, was there to contribute. And Sheriff Apperson was there to give his comments. Paul Kritz hosted that, and it was very much appreciated. The Rodeo Association Queen Contest was at the fairgrounds. We went there and saw three great talented kids, 14-year-olds, two of them, and a 9-year-old, and sure make their parents proud what they're doing. It was a great evening. Attended the Dancing with the Stars event at the Veterans Hall. Just want to congratulate the city of Crescent City and Eric Weir. I did not know he could dance that way, move his legs that way, but they really put on a good show. Hands down, they were 10 plus, and they did a great job. So I say, well, you must have got your talents doing all this great, quick work on B Street, which is now the B Street Project, and I'm really happy to tell you that Front Street is now open. So they've really worked well. Thank goodness we have good weather. And they're moving forward. Now there's some cleanup work, but Front Street is now open, and I want to give a big congratulations and thanks for all your great work, Eric Weir, and Public Works and the B Street. Followed up on a number of constituent issues and contacted both the city and staff to follow up on some discarded mattresses, some graffiti, and other blight, both in the city and the county. And that's my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Supervisor Howard.
Thank you, Chair. I would like to start off today's report with a little article I read in the Sacramento Bee last week, specific to Center Coast Hospital. It kind of shocked me based on the presentations that we were receiving from Mitch Hanna not too long ago. It ranked Center Coast number 2 in a university study from the Washington and Lee University in Virginia, number 2 in profits in acute patient care in the United States out of 3,000 hospitals. My jaw about hit the floor when I read this article, because that's 3,000 hospitals, and yet this study was conducted in 2013, supposedly when the profitability of Center Coast was not so great. And I've got to question what I read, obviously, and peel through it with a fine-tooth comb, but bottom line is that there does seem to be a large profit margin there resting on the backs of many of our citizens, and we need to pay, and I know this board is paying a great deal of attention to what Center Coast is doing, but more importantly, I think as we move forward with discussions with the healthcare district, we need to look for options that are competitive for all our citizens in this community. Attended a presentation by Dr. John Powell that was hosted by Building Healthy Communities this week. Excellent presentation. Also had a great deal of discussion on a topic that will be on our agenda today for outstanding national resource waters. Talked with staff, talked to their director, Matt St. John, and do plan on attending a water, North Coast Regional Water Quality Control Board meeting in Goleta at the request of Matt St. John to discuss the board's position that we took recently. Also attend a tri-agency meeting this last week with Supervisor Finnegan. Interesting movement there with tri-agency. Heard reports from Council Economic Advisors specific to NRW, and also moving forward with a study that's long overdue on tourism and its impacts on our community. Attended a dinner in Eureka. I see Neil Ewald here with Janet Napolitano, who's the current UC president for the state of California. Very interesting dinner. One bright note in some of the conversation we had with Ms. Napolitano was the real effort that the UC system wants to take to make UC accessible for state of California students, more specific to ensuring that transfer from community colleges to the UC systems is available. And it appears to be one of her bigger focuses in three of the large items that she wanted addressed during her tenure. Also attended the Delaware County Transportation Commission meeting. Among the items we discussed was Highway 199 and specifically problems that we're seeing around milepost 10.5. I know Caltrans has their positions, but I've heard recently from our local transportation commission director that Caltrans is aware of the issues. They're looking at them, but more importantly, they may have found a temporary fix to take a look at, and we'll be discussing that on Thursday at our local transportation commission meeting. Attended the Resource Conservation District meetings and meetings of the Farm Bureau to discuss specifically Senate Bill 88, which has drastic effects on many folks, including our community service districts, on how they measure water. And you'll see an item on our agenda today discussing that. Attended the Chamber Economic Summit. It was a great presentation we saw there from Jeff Harris, Superintendent of Schools, and talking about our youth and the education of our youth, and more specifically where we need to go with that education. You know this board's focused on it a great deal here in the last couple of years, but making sure we move upstream. Moving upstream basically to our 0 to 5 age kids to ensure that they're having a great deal of success before they enter kindergarten. And that's where our success most likely is going to be achieved based on what Jeff is telling us. And in particular, continue to work on programs like career technical education and making sure those programs are in place in Delaware High, because I know they're in place when Jerry went through school because he got his aviation license at that time. Also attended a Natural Resource Goals Committee meeting where we discussed many of the water issues on our agenda today. Also proactive goals, financial goals committee meeting, which I know Matthew will be presenting on that today. Some meetings with constituents, one specific to Nautical Heights, and then also meeting with District Attorney Dale Trigg.
Thank you. Supervisor Finnegan.
Thank you. I also had a few meetings, and I'll try not to be too redundant or repetitive. Had a meeting with regarding indoor play space. It's a collaborative between the Child Care Council, the county, the schools, the city, First Five, talking about other areas and the needs to be met. Our children have place to go and exercise, play, run programs when the weather is inclement. Went to a tri-agency meeting. Supervisor Howard spoke about the economic advisors. I think we've finally seen some juice back in that tri-agency. A lot of movement there around broadband as well as tourism. Had a homeless meeting with the sheriff and the group that we've been meeting for about 6 months now behind the scenes. We've stayed out of the headlines so we could actually make some effective changes. I see now the sheriff is in the headlines, we're going to continue to do it, let the other people take the credit. And Delmarne High School, went to the youth council the other night regarding just fantastic youth that are involved in that, and talked about underage drinking, local transportation commission meeting that Supervisor Howard talked about, and of course the forum that Supervisor Gitlin talked about. Went to a little social thing at the art gallery. Laura Weens used to be here when her husband was the editor of the Triplicate. Had an art showing here from Hawaii. Nice to see some old friends. Went to the proactive financial management. You're going to hear from the airport director in a little bit. Unanimously approved that proposal. send to the board. Went down to Humboldt County to meet with the operating engineers. There's a lot of hot air going around about proposals for last chance grade, and I thought I'd take it upon myself to go down and talk to the guys that are going to be running the cats and the earth movers and see just what it entails and to hear some of the stories from what happened with the old bypass, and not even talking about the geology that has to be done or the environmental concerns and stuff like that. And they had a few choice words, and it definitely wasn't in favor of this shortened proposal. Went to the airport JPA meeting. Great stuff happening there, and maybe I'll, don't want to steal any thunder, maybe you can mention something happening on the 18th that we're going to do out there. And all good news. And went to the Elk Valley Rancheria, as did Supervisor Howard and most of us, I think, and listened to the presentation about focusing on community and understanding people towards collaborative effort. Humboldt State University, Building Health Communities, Wild Rivers, and all those. Threw in a couple of family birthdays, and yeah, it's election time, so what, right? So you don't need to hear about it. We'll be knocking on your door. If you have any questions, please call. Thanks.
Thanks. Supervisor McClure.
Yes, thank you. I've been busy the last couple of weeks, of course, with the election and all of that kind of activity, but more importantly, I've been doing some of the work of the community, and my biggest, happiest moment this week was at the Senior Center meeting. And at that meeting, we reviewed what we've been doing. We've served about 17,000 meals so far this program year. We just received an additional $50,000 for our limited program activity, which is stuff for seniors. So that $50,000 will now come in and will end up in a program. And one of the programs we're looking at is the volunteer driver program. So that's pretty exciting too, because the Senior Center, we were struggling for such a long time, and now we've turned to this corner. We've also, the IHEAP weatherization program that deals with helping people if they get behind on their utilities, or helping people buy pellets, or actually now the program for weatherization is up and running, and we're gonna actually make people's houses more energy efficient. And that's a $500,000 program that comes into our community. And just last month alone, on just the utility and the home heating, we did over $70,000 in assistance to people who needed to make sure their heat stayed on, or to make sure that they had wood in their yard, or to make sure that they had pellets. So all of that is available to people, and it's based on income, and people should be applying because we still have money for assistance there. So please pick up the telephone and call the Senior Center, and they'll give you all of the directions of what to do. I also did the solid waste review for the upcoming agenda, but more importantly, we met and are in negotiations with Hambros to extend their contract to be able to make sure that those living waste jobs are going to stay alive in our community, and it gives them as a company the ability to raise themselves up in relationship to buying equipment and that kind of thing. So we did that. I participated in the bike to school event, where the kids all came in and they all had to answer questions about safety issues of crossing the street, riding bikes, and that kind of thing. That was very exciting. The Historical Society, we had a meeting, and we're going to plan probably to do a evening of everyone remembering about Wally, the editor of the American. So we're working on that, and stay tuned to that. I also attended the Economic Summit and was very impressed that at last year's event, it was kind of a flatliner. Everyone was, but this year it was like everything was coming up, and people were, it was like all these positive reports of what people are doing in the community and what they're doing at the high school and what the real estate is improving. And it was just kind of an uplifting thing, because I think that the majority of the people want everybody's vote to rise. So that's exciting. EMS, we had a phone meetings. There's some changes happening in ambulance service that we're doing some research on that could be, where it's actually changing, that the doctor doesn't make the decision of where you go, but a service makes the decision. And so we want to not let that, we don't want to alter. We want to have the patient-doctor relationship. So we're working on that, and I want everyone to go on Thursday and buy crab. So we're going to have crab, so we should just have a giant crab out in Delmar County, be at the docks and getting crab. Thanks.
Great, thanks. Well, I had a few meetings. After our presentation from the Regional Water Quality Control Board, we had a follow-up meeting that I attended, tried to get some dialogue going and questions answered. As both Supervisor Finnegan and Howard said, we had a local transportation commission meeting, had a couple of meetings about crab. We had a natural resource committee meeting, which we seemed to be talking about all things water, more or less. So those discussions are continuing on. Had a meeting with Grant Werschkel, who he and I co-chair a collaborative group with the Forest Service and special interest groups, as well as industry, just a myriad of people, the tribes. And so we're continually working on agendas and projects that we're going to be moving forward, hopefully soon. I did agenda review, and as Supervisor Finnegan said, we had a Border Coast Regional Airport Authority meeting. All things good. I see both Susan and Matthew are here, so they will give us a little presentation on that. That was about it for me. Jay, a little something for us on a...
Yeah, over the last couple of weeks, I've been busy with a lot of different HR issues, everything from meetings to interviews for preparing for negotiations. Have had some budget meetings in preparation for the upcoming budget process, meetings with department heads, been working on a city and county agreement that hopefully will be finished and on to the next agenda if we can get it through this last step, which I think is going to happen. Attended the Natural Resources Committee meeting, had a meeting with our public defenders to go over their contract, which is being considered at this point. Went to the tri-agency meeting, went to the proactive financial management committee meeting, and a little sadder note, I wanted to recognize the passing of Dale Thomas. A lot of people know Dale. Yep. He was one of my teachers and my basketball coach, and I saw Donnie was here too, so I'm sure he was there when Dale was around, because Donnie was one of my coaches also.
Yeah.
Martha.
We?
Yeah.
And I did mean to make mention of that. We had a little gathering out at the golf course a week ago, and his son was here, Kevin, and of course a lot of his friends. Pretty sad. He was not only a coach and a teacher, but also a very good friend of mine. Sorry that he had to depart.
Yep.
Go ahead.
I was fortunate to be able to talk with him over the last several years, as not a student, obviously, or a bad student at that. But very fortunate to have gotten to know him a little bit, and a very nice guy, great guy.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. So we're going to take up, we have a budget transfer, amount of $8,500 child support services. We have a motion.
Move to approve.
I have a motion and a second. Any public comment on this budget transfer? Okay, seeing no public comment, then we'll bring it back to the board. Any further discussion? Kylie, would you call the vote, please?
Supervisor Howard?
Yes.
Supervisor Gitlin?
Yes.
Supervisor Finnegan?
Yes.
Supervisor McClure?
Yes.
Chair Hemmingson?
Yes. Okay, it is 10:25, so we're going to have a public comment period. Members of the public may address the board on matters which are within the jurisdiction of the board. If you are addressing the board regarding a matter listed on the agenda, you may be asked to hold your comments until the board takes up that matter. Please limit your comments to 3 minutes. Is there any public comment?
I noticed there was an important item that is not on your agenda that needs commenting, and that is for the mineral withdrawal, a support letter. The EA is out, and your letters are due by the 27th of this month. And that is the mineral withdrawal that Huffman, DeFazio, and other Oregon representatives have been working so hard to get for us, and McGuire as well. I would hope that you would support the mineral withdrawal of the Southern Oregon, Southwest Oregon area, that is the minimal action we need to take to protect our water quality. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other public comment?
Good morning. My name is Ellie Kim Bauer. I'm a licensed psychologist, doctor of psychology, and clinical psychology, sole proprietor of Synergistic Services. The name Synergistic Services is exactly why I'm here. It's because it takes all of us in a synergy to work together and to be part of the solution rather than complaining about the problems. I have here, with regard to Barbara Pearson's letter of resignation, what I'm asking is that you are to not receive that letter, and rather to reinstate her, support her as the director of the Department of Health and Human Services. I've written a letter to you. I have different letters here, three, from Synergistic Services, myself and two assistants. A letter from Pastor Steve Perez, which has also been sent to you before, and a letter from the Dunlop Community Health Wellness Center and the behavioral health consultant there, as well as the site administrator. These letters are for you. I think probably the best way I can use the time that I have is to read to you the number and the variety of stakeholders that are supporting Barbara Pearson in her work, in her capacity, and in her incredible humility, but her innovation and her willingness to speak for those who have little voice or not much. So here are the community stakeholders, all of which support Barbara Pearson to remain. Scott Feller, RHS. Ron Phillips, RHS. Renee Quintana, LHS. Athena Costoras, North Coast Children's Services. Angela Glor, First Five. Karen Saturn, Redwood Coast Regional Center. Mike Byrne, Full Spectrum. Patrick Cleary, Humboldt Area Foundation, Eureka. Jim McQuillan, MFT, Marriage and Family Therapist, Education Department, Yurok Tribe. Lori Nesbitt, Probation Yurok Tribe. Ron Bates, Probation Yurok Tribe. Dorothy Waite, Community and Family Services Director, Tallawa Tribe. Open Door, Jan Schwarzkopf, Corey Mitchum, and Hilda Contreras. Rob Christensen, Kathleen Moxon, Ron Cole, Andy Jensen, Dr. Ellie Kimbauer, Dr. Hal Nemitz, Dr. Julie Bayon, Dr. Todd Roy, Jonathan Harkness in Coos Bay, the VA in Coos Bay, Stuart Nichols, Community Assistance Network, Patty Vernelson, Marianne Fallman, Ian Mansal, Cheryl Simons, Craig Bradford, Big Rock Services District, Ron Placetti, Bobby Strever, Holmes helps with the homeless lunches, Chair Harvey, Jerry Johnson, VFW Commander, Vicki Levitt, Employee, Daphne Cortez, Dean, and Mike, J. Justice at Our Daily Bread Ministries, Tom Pawlowski at Reach Out Ministries. These are...
Thank you very much. Your time is concluded.
Okay.
I appreciate your comments.
Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. And I'm personally going to make a comment on that list that you just read. You can sit down. Every person that I called on that list was not aware that they were on the list, because the list was sent to me with phone numbers. And so the people that I called were not aware they were on the list and would ask me if I would take them off the list. I said, it's not my list. And I did email that list out to some of the people that that had asked me to, that I talked to. So I just want to clarify that for anybody who's listening. I don't know if any of the rest of the board members hadn't gotten that, but I feel it's a little disingenuous to send something out that people don't even know that they're on the list. Is there any other public comment? Okay, seeing no other public comment, then we're going to close the public comment period. And we do have a 10:30 timed item. Neil Ewald from Green Diamond Resource Company is going to give us a little update. Neil, thanks for coming. Have you got a presentation?
Yes, I do. Chairman Henningsen, members of the board, thank you for giving me this time. I will be brief as soon as I can get the slideshow up and running.
Okay.
I think staring at beautiful pictures of the woods is probably a lot better than looking at me. So we should have it here in a moment. But just to give you a brief reason for my attendance here is we are the largest private landowner in Del Mar County. And in a recent meeting with Supervisor Howard, it became clear that we hadn't been here in a while, and there have been some changes to our company. And so what I'd like to do is give you an update on our company, talk a little bit more specifically about what's going on in Del Mar County, and then save some time for questions. So I think I have the means to change the slides, if you bear with me a moment. Okay, we'll see if remote sensing works. So what about Green Diamond Resource Company? I am the senior vice president at Green Diamond. My job is to manage the lands of in Humboldt and Del Mar counties. We have about 400,000 acres here in California, about 300,000 acres in our Washington properties. And what's new for us in the last couple of years, last year, in fact, was the acquisition of 600,000 acres in South Central Oregon in around Klamath Falls. What's new on the negative side is the our elimination of our sawmill in Del Mar County, or in Humboldt County. We're no longer manufacturing redwood and Douglas fir lumber, but that does not mean we're not committed to staying in the timber business. In fact, let me talk a little bit about where we are now here focused in Del Norte. We have approximately 92,000 acres in Del Norte County. As you can see, our employees here in Del Norte are about significantly different than we were some years ago. We eliminated our company logging business, but just because they're not company loggers doesn't mean they're not working on the property. So the contractors are involved in our business number about 180. So we'll talk about harvest levels here in a minute at the end of the presentation to give you a sense of magnitude. But some of things have not changed since I was here last. We've maintained our commitment to keep ground-based logging to shovel logging, which means there are no tractor trails. And you look on the hillside, you won't see that image on the hillside. But what is new is our commitment to doing thinning. Over the last 2 years, we've committed to 5,000 acres of thinning. About a third of that will be in Del Norte County. I'm personally gratified at that because as a young forester, I helped create some of these stands and now they're merchantable again. So it's personally gratifying to me. Something that hasn't changed, I think the last time I was here, I reported that we were certified by the Forest Stewardship Council. We maintain that certification through this time. But what has changed since we're here is the standards for retention, and we're hopeful you can see those on the hillside. We're leaving a lot more trees in our even age management. It's an example of one of those photographs. And another thing that hasn't changed is our commitment to long-term stewardship. We have two federal permits to manage endangered species, one for the spotted owl that was approved in 1992, and another for all the aquatic habitat species that we have. And the featured part of those permits on the aquatic side is our road plan. We will remove, as you can see there in the fine print, a significant amount of sediment from our system. Our commitment is $3 million of work every year. And that will accelerate with the inflation as time goes forward. We're also doing adaptive management, so we're not arrogant enough to believe we have it all figured out, and so the experiments that we produce and the evaluations we do on our landscape allow us to change prescriptions. One of those adaptive management pieces is our interest in how spotted owls thrive on our landscape, where in fact how they don't thrive. And you see here in the lower right corner the picture of a barred owl. We are in the process of trying to produce a renewal of one of our permits to acknowledge that barred owls are upon the scene, and by managing those we can be a bit of a haven for spotted owls going forward. And so stay tuned for an updated HCP in the public forum here. We're hopeful by the end of the year. So what about Del Mar County? Since 2000 we have completed 57 stream enhancement projects in cooperation with Yurok Tribe and the Rural Human Services. Dan Burgess, I think, was the primary gatekeeper to those. So we're happy to continue those. This is one in Rowdy Creek, another one in Lower McGarvey. But something that's new is when we begin harvesting in some of the visual areas, you can see from highways, some North Bank Road in particular, and Highway 101, we're trying to make sure that we don't leave our fingerprint there that is something that would manage or something that would damage the view. And so here's a couple of pictures of examples of that from Highway 101 at Rose Lane and on North Bank Road. So that leads us to a couple of more issues that are pertinent to you all, and that is I think about 8 years ago is when we started this transaction with the Yurok Tribe, selling them approximately 47,000 acres. It's been progressing from south to north through Humboldt County. There's about 9,000 acres remaining to be sold, and about 6,000 of those are in Del Norte. So stand by for that progress. We're hoping to have that wrapped up in 2 years. And finally, Last Chance Grade, as you know, we're the landowner of the southern portion of Last Chance Grade, and it's our hope that we can make whatever alignment happens as west as possible, so it doesn't use as little as our land as possible. But one thing we want to offer is that if we do have a cataclysmic failure of that road, there is an alternative route around the backside that we took Chairman Gitlin on a review of that here not long ago. It's open, I think, for emergency services. It wouldn't be suitable for the public to use, but who knows what reason it might be for someone who wants to get from Humboldt to Del Norte after a cataclysm like that. So this is the slide that I wanted to end with. This is the slide of the future for our company. As you know, we essentially went away from Del Mar County after the recession, and we're on our way back up. Our harvest levels are now in and around 35 million feet, and that's a sustainable level for us. Now, we're hopeful that we have no ugly recessions coming our way, but I can tell you that left to our own devices, we're continuing that 35 million feet on into the future, and without any disruptions, I said economically, we'll be here for good. So where I can answer any questions, one thing I wanted to add as I offer the questions, we have a tour, a forestry tour we give every year in Humboldt County, and we've neglected Del Norte. So it's our interest to come back this year, sometime in the summer, and put a public tour together and offer it up to members of the board. So you can see what we do up close and personal, and we'll, a little more time than 7 minutes of visuals.
Neil, we appreciate that. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, I just want to offer myself up for any questions you might have.
Yeah, well, I know we appreciate that offer. I know we took, I know Supervisor Sullivan and I took a little tour. I think, Chris, when you worked for Green Diamond, I think you were part of that little tour, but we did take a little tour. We would appreciate that again, so I appreciate the offer. That's great. I appreciate your presentation. Very valuable information. Any questions from board members? Yes, go ahead, Mark.
When you put up a slide with the owl and trying to get the permit again to be able to manage,
right?
What about the fisher? Because I think that one is probably going to even be bigger than the owl.
Yes, we've been in discussions with the Fish and Wildlife Service for 8 years, I think. And one of the reasons it's taken so long is that we're not just updating our plan for owls, we're updating the plan to add protection for fishers, okay, and for red and Sonoma tree voles. We're trying to make it a multi-species plan. In fact, we're also seeking a safe harbor for the Humboldt Martin, which exists in the northern part of our ownership in our Klamath operation. So it's a multi-species plan, but in order to add a species to the list, we have to know something about it. So thankfully, we've been studying fishers now for over a decade.
Great. And then one final question in relationship to the marijuana grows and the poisoning of the landscape.
Yeah.
And you're being stewards. How is that affecting your property?
Yeah, we do our best to police our landscape. We're not trying to be vigilantes. We just want to make sure that if someone wants to grow marijuana, they think twice about coming to us. And so because of that, we're also concerned about the safety of our employees. Some of them have been turned away at gunpoint over the years. But our objective is to make sure that, unfortunately, the people, if they're going to do it, they do it somewhere else. But the two biggest impacts we've seen on other lands adjacent to ours is dewatering of streams and the use of pesticides. And some of these are illegal, not even allowed in the United States. So it's a big deal for us. Many of the animals that use our landscape have been detected to have rodenticide in their system. So it even leaks in from the outside, if you will.
Okay, thank you.
Appreciate it. Supervisor Gitlin.
Neil, first of all, thanks very much for coming to our meeting and updating us. I hope you'll come more regularly.
Yes, an annual event.
Right. Tell us a little bit about Road 200. I know you mentioned about the steep grade. I think it was John Davis, you know, we were out there with Chuck Blackburn, former supervisor, Kurt Stremberg, Ruth Ann Schulte, and you took us on this Road 200, and I asked where we're going, and I think one of you said, it may have been Ruth Ann, it may have been John, I said, what's that way? He says, that's 101, right over there, and I guess it was a matter of less than a mile or something like that. Now, I don't remember the steep grade, because I don't think we were on any kind. So is the grade, the downward grade, you're elevated up, is it on that road at that point where it goes down and it's, in your opinion, it's not a good alternative route?
Yeah, there are really two routes to consider. One is a route that is the emergency access, and that's the one that goes quite a ways east before it turns north. So it is on reasonably steep ground, and it dead ends at the park. Somewhere, I think, on the old Millerama property. That wouldn't be a reasonable alignment for a road. Even Caltrans has suggested that that's not the case. A better alignment is on the opposite side of the ridge to where the highway exists today. So if you imagine Highway 101 on the west side of the ridge that parallels the north part of Wilson Creek, the road on the east side of that ridge, we do have another logging road there. It doesn't connect all the way through. And so it would have to go through, I think it would either be parkland or other pieces of realm land, but there's no road connecting it. So it may be a better alignment in the end, but it's not a good emergency access.
Next time you come here, would you be in a position to show us some graphics on that alternative route, not 200, but the one you're referring
sure.
to now?
Sure, yeah, in fact.
And any other roads that could be used as alternatives for when we refer to the cataclysmic collapse of Last Chance Grade.
Right.
Perhaps the next time you come up here, and I'm going to ask that you come up at least quarterly, if you can do that.
Great, I'll give my best.
And then by doing that, get the public in the loop of what are the options.
Sure. We certainly have a preferred option for us. It's one that uses less of our land, obviously. But I can show you that option in the emergency access. And we do need to make that, I think, it's not, if the road were to fail tomorrow, I don't think you can drive through it. And so there needs to be a little work done on the park side to make sure the access is all the way. I think it comes out at Hamilton Road. So we can come back and talk to you about both those things if you'd like.
Oh, a couple of things. Good to
sure.
see you again, Neil.
Thank you.
You know, thanks. Regarding Last Chance Grade, I commend you for being part of the process, the congressional stakeholders, and right. hope that you adhere to that. We work within that framework.
Right.
It's working, as you know. The other thing is, you know, as a member of the, I guess it's Cal Fire's Demonstration Forest Advisory Committee.
Right.
It's always been extremely frustrating for me to know of companies like Green Diamond or Simpson in the past that had excellent forest management practices, and yet, you know, they're not heralded as much as some of the companies that weren't taking care of business and or the Forest Service.
Right.
And you know, some of your slides there showed the thinning. And people don't seem to understand, it's just not, I mean, that economically and environmentally, they can be synonymous and the same, and you're doing an excellent job. And I wish you could tell that story more often and louder. It not only curtails forest fire, but it adds to the economic benefit of the stands, as well as water quality, as well as environmental quality and all that. So just, you know, pat yourself on the back, and I wish that that demonstration forest advisory was a little more vocal on some of the stuff. Good job. Good to see you.
Well, thank you for that. And to add to our commitment to come back to Delmar County, we are, in addition to the forestry tour we went upon this year, we're also hoping to be at the fair this year with a booth. It's been a long time since we've been there, so maybe we can help interpret what we do at the fair with a booth.
And the fair needs you.
Thank you.
Supervisor Howard.
I'd be remiss not to pick out my old boss over here.
I can't hurt you anymore.
No, I quick question.
You don't know that.
Quick question. The Forest Stewardship Council piece of the certification, great addition to what you're doing.
Thank you.
Can you expand a little bit more on the community involvement piece and how that might impact Delmar County going forward?
Yeah, part of the entry fee, if you will, for being certified through Forest Stewardship Council is that we ask what the community thinks about what we're doing, and that we listen and take action on what we've heard. In fact, one of the things that we heard is that we should become more involved in Delmar County. We were remiss, and I think the first time we came to Delmar County for this sort of listening event was just this last year. And so from that, it became more clear to us that we needed more involvement in Delmar, so we put a plan together to do that. You heard about the fair and the tour, and we're hoping to get involved more in the Chamber of Commerce and so on. So we're some people who have not yet found out at our company will become members of some of the organizations here in Delmar. So I'd hate to let them hear in the findings of the Delmar of this meeting what their assignments are. But we are indeed listening to what we heard at the FSC communications meeting we had with you.
And then, just to top it off, I you know, Jerry and I have had the opportunity to attend a lot of Fish and Game Commission meetings. And really appreciative of your staff, more importantly Gary Rainerson, and his attentive to issues that not only affect Green Diamond but also our communities. I mean, these are long-term issues, and I think it reflects well on the effort that Green Diamond in particular puts into the science of finding out really what's happening on the landscape. And it's so very important. And the most recent meeting around the Northern Spotted Owl, where Dr. Diller got up in front of the commission and was able to show everybody in the room that there are two sides to every story, and more important, that there's a collaborative process that can be worked through. With Green Diamond, you know, really helping to spearhead the cutting edge science on this, it is so very important to carry that message forward, and you guys do it so well with your staff. I have to compliment you on that.
Well, thank you. We have a mantra at work. We want to know more about our lands than anyone else. So sometimes we get to talk to others about that, too. So thank you for that.
Neil, thank you so much. I appreciate it. And I'd like to extend an open invitation. You can come as often as you want.
Well, in the words of our ex-governor, I will be back.
Good to see you, Gary.
Any public comment on this presentation? Okay, seeing no public comment.
I was wondering, who were the experts that he's associated with for the salmon and for the owls and all that? If you could add, that he's working.
Yeah, it's not really question and answer, just a public comment is all I was looking for.
Okay.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Okay, seeing no more public comment, we're going to move on to our 10:45 timed item. You have some public comment?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Mr. Hemmingson.
Yes.
I think it's disingenuous that you would only call some of the people on that stakeholder list. I know for a fact.
Excuse me, but this is a public comment on the presentation that was just done by Green Diamond.
Okay, I apologize, but I do want you to know that that is disingenuous on your part. It's not appreciated.
Okay. Okay, we're moving on to our 10:45 timed item, airport terminal project presentation. Matthew?
Yes,
Susan?
Sir.
Welcome.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Chairman Hemmingson, supervisors, members of the staff, audience, and public. It's a pleasure to be before you here this morning to discuss our new terminal project. We have a presentation that we basically bifurcated into two distinct parts. The first is an overview, which many of you are familiar with, so I'll expedite out of respect for your time. And then we'll get into the financing and hopefully enlistment of your support as the County of Del Norte as a co-applicant for our USDA loan. Pursuant to Supervisor Finnegan's statement earlier, we have some very exciting news. Our groundbreaking for the terminal project is scheduled to be held on May 18th from 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. It's going to be quite a party. We enlisted the help and support of our contractors, consultants, and construction managers to avoid the use of airport or public funds for that event, and they all stepped forward and were very gracious and generous with their contributions. So that should be very exciting. To begin the presentation, this is going to be our new terminal as rendered by our artists and construction management firm. You'll notice on the upper left-hand corner, we have Pen Air signage and kiosks. It's germane to note that their construction and facility, or excuse me, properties and facilities person will be in town on the 12th to discuss this further. They're very supportive of this. It's going to offer a lot more capacity, and it's going to be commensurate with their future growth potential and plans. It's also important to note that this is the terminal that'll be serving our community, and I often joke and tell we're a spaceport. We're looking at the next 20, 30, 40 years. Yes, exactly. What we have right now is woefully inadequate for a 30-seat platform, let alone what we anticipate to arrive in future years, namely a 70-seat Q400 or CRJ700, which our runways can accommodate. The upper right-hand corner is a picture of Castle Rock as viewed from the passenger waiting area. You know, it's a great showcase of this area, which we truly live in and don't merely exist. It'll definitely enhance the aesthetics as experienced by passengers. It's important to note that this terminal is the conduit to our region and our community, and I think this is a great way to showcase it. The lower left-hand corner is what is presently the modular trailer. That'll be the TSA secure area. So you can see that offers a lot of improvement over where we're presently at. And then lower right-hand corner is the parking lot and realigned Dale Rupert Road, which will be an integral part of phase one. I'm going to get into a little bit of value engineering as we engaged in, and that'll be a big part of that. But as you guys know, most of you know, right now, when you arrive at CEC, there's not even a baggage claim. You know, they just kind of put the suitcases on the floor, and it's a sea of humanity and dysfunction. So this is going to be great. Okay, this is part of our phase one, the new water and sewer adjacent to Pebble Beach. Coordination has begun with, is in place with tribal representatives regarding any ground disturbance, and it'll go along the realigned Dale Rupert Road as well. Okay, this is the alternates. It's important to note, I mentioned value engineering earlier. These will be bid as alternates, with the exception of the aircraft apron, and I'll get into that in a little bit. So if the bids come in lower than we anticipate, these will be distinct possibilities if we have the funding. The parking lot was $628,000 of savings. What we did is we removed a canopy, which was going to go up the middle of the parking lot and offer shelter from the elements, and we reduced the total capacity from 102 to 66 spaces. With regard to that, we'll have the current parking that's on the north side of Dale Rupert Road, south of the present terminal, for ancillary space, should we need it. For excess. The aircraft apron, if we were going to build the full apron as originally designed, we would have to relocate the FAA antenna field, which is on the west side of Dale Rupert Road, just before you get to the airport rescue and firefighting building. That would require an inordinate amount of environmental permitting. There'd have to be coordination with the FAA to remove those antennas, relocate them, recalibrate them. That would take years. So by having the aircraft apron, we can still accommodate a 70-seat platform. We can still accommodate what we presently have. If we ever had two aircraft of that size at the airport at any given moment, we can utilize the existing apron north of the current terminal. So that shouldn't be a problem. The roof was originally going to be a zinc roof, custom made. We determined that about $500,000 of savings could be present if we were to go with a pre-engineered structural frame and roof. With regard to the elements, it's very robust as designed. It should withstand the physical environment here. with no significant issues. And total, that is just under $2 million. So we've done our utmost to pare the cost down as best we can over the course of this project. So two construction phases and three grants. The first phase is going to be phase one, which we anticipate receiving the grant for sometime this week from FAA in Washington, D.C. This is already paid for. This bid was awarded to Tidewater Construction out of Brookings. There are three parts to this: the water sewer infrastructure, which you saw a little bit earlier, the Dale Rupert Road and roundabout. The roundabout will be near where the FedEx trailer is now, on the north side of Dale Rupert Road, and then our off-site ongoing mitigation at Pacific Shores and Bay Meadows. Phase two, we anticipate will begin late this summer, early this autumn. That'll be the terminal itself, the parking lot, the apron, and so forth, and that's what we're going to be largely talking about today. We anticipate construction going until about the spring of 2018, likely, correct, Susan? I mean, if in a perfect world, we'd probably be wrapping it up at the end of 2017, but realistically, that's what we're looking at insofar as a timeline. That's another overview, again, of how things are going to go. We anticipate phase one beginning on or around June 1st, and then you'll definitely notice some changes. It's going to be really exciting as they realign the road and get rid of the water tower and install the roundabout and so forth. Phase two, of course, is the terminal, the apron, the parking lot, landscaping, and then removal of the existing Quonset hangar on the south side of the airport. And then, and I've been through this once before and I can't wait to do it again, the actual transition. When we move all the equipment one night from the old facility to the new, tow the aircraft, and you know, passengers come in one night, it's the old facility, they depart from the new, the coffee's brewing, and we're cutting the ribbon. So we're certainly looking forward to that. Any questions on my part of the presentation? Thank you.
Susan? Any questions or comments from board members for Matthew at this time? Go ahead, Susan.
Okay, thanks. So then we get into the financing end of it, and that's been the challenge. This shows the layout of the offices and areas of the new airport terminal. The areas that are in orange are the ones that are ineligible for FAA funding, and then the ones that are in yellow are partially ineligible. The FAA funding does not extend to any areas that are going to be rented out. So that's our air carrier, that's TSA. It does not extend to airport administrative offices either. So shared facilities are then also done at a prorated basis for ineligible space. So we end up just on the terminal building itself with 18.22% of that cost that goes into ineligible. This slide shows the full use of FAA funding. And the amount on the second line for FAA funding of $17,166,898.00 is exactly what the FAA has available for this project. And it's available over three grants, the first of them being $6 million, which is the one that's due in this week. So in figuring out what would be the full use of the FAA funding, we started with that number. So we have, at that point, with the ineligible amount of our terminal building at $1,008,000, we would come up with a total of $19,923,847. So if you go into the first column on the eligible section of that, the $18 million there, $17 million, 95% of it is FAA funded. That remaining 5% is the funding would come from the Del Norte County loan that exists currently. That leaves out of that Del Norte County loan an additional almost $500,000 that could come over against the ineligible funding. Just a quick refresher, that loan was originally $1.8 million. It was for originally the RSA-related work. We were able to get funding on enough of that that only about $400,000 by the end of this year will be used for the runway safety area. That remaining $1.4 million is then being applied to the terminal. So anyway, so that would leave $500,000 there out of the ineligible. The BACRA reserves, and that's generally based on the time of Matthews and mine that goes into the grant work, would bring it down another $122,000. that means that we still need funding for $1.2 million if the bids come in as high as it looks like the construction manager has estimated them. Okay. So then we go to potential reduction, and I have to make an emphasis on the word potential because the potential is an ODOT Connect Oregon 6 grant that we have applied for. Originally, we were rated pretty high based on the grant application, but when we attended the modal committee review up in Portland, we were not very well received, mainly as a out-of-state airport. And they dropped us clear down the list for noting things such as the size of the project, that we were out of state, and that there were a lot of airport projects up this year for Connect Oregon grants. On the 24th of this month, we'll be going to Roseburg for the regional committee, and we're going to go prepared to address the things that they brought up regarding the size of the project, because there were some misconceptions there that without being asked questions, we were not able to address. So we go to the modal, or we've been to the modal committee, next we go to regional. When you get to regional, they have a far better understanding of what this airport means to Oregon and what our connections are and just how close we are. So we are currently revising our presentation. We go up there on the 24th and we're gonna give it everything we have. That application was for $584,210. Obviously, if we were awarded, if we are awarded that grant, then that brings the Del Norte County loan funds back over to, I'm sorry, that eliminates the need for the rest of the Del Norte County loan funds that would be against the eligible and bring that much over to ineligible, which then leaves us with $650,739 that we would need to finish up the ineligible portion. It's complicated, and if you have questions, I'd be glad to answer them. So the AIP grant application for the next phase will be submitted after the terminal construction bid is complete. At that time, we have to know, because there'll be a portion of the terminal in phase two when we apply for that next grant in August, we need to know where our funding is coming from. The Connect Oregon grant, if awarded, is not awarded until August of 2016. Okay, on the USDA loan, the original thought was that with a USDA loan, we could pay back the $1.8 million that we'll use from Del Norte County funds, and also the additional either $1.2 or $650,000 that we would need. So total USDA loan that we're looking at, top dollar would be about $3 million. And to do that, we need to have a co-applicant. The payments on those, depending on whether it's a 30-year or 40-year loan, would be anywhere from on the low end, the $122,911, to the high end, if it's $3 million and we go at 30 years, of $208,984.
Who pays that?
The payment on that loan would have to come from our member agencies, or also from, by assuming a co-applicant status from the county would be the one that would be guaranteeing those payments. So the pre-application process on the USDA loan has to begin right of way, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in a minute. So on our summary, the potential gap funding that's needed is $650,000 to the $1.2 million. We have to have a co-applicant for any long-term funding, and then a determination has to be made on payments towards long-term funding. So the bottom line that we've been presenting to all of our other member agencies is that each agency has to determine what they can and will do to assist with this project. And when we originally started presenting this, we were presenting it as 30 years, we're going to have these payments, and it basically set people back because they didn't want to commit to that long a period. So what we've been asking them is, tell us what you can do. Let us work with what you can do, and we'll start from there. So can you contribute over a period of years towards the long-term debt? How much? How long? Can you assist in the gap funding through grants, through gifts, or through low-interest loans? And can you be the co-applicant for a USDA loan? So the one thing that we know for sure from all of them is that we don't have another member willing to be a co-applicant on the USDA loan. We do know that Brookings is working with us on that ODOT loan. We do know that Elk Valley Rancheria is looking very hard, I'm sorry, that ODOT grant. Elk Valley Rancheria is looking very hard for grant funding as well. We will be at the City of Crescent City Budget Council meeting on the 23rd of this month, and are hoping that at that point that they will be willing to commit to some of the funding as well. In the meantime, we are at the point that we have to get an application in for that USDA loan, and it needs to be fast. It needs to be by the end of May. We have to have that letter of conditions from them in place prior to going out to bid, which we want to do at the 1st of August for the second phase of the terminal. And we have to have that in place in order to have the language in that, in the, those bid documents, and come to find out, before they would pay for anything on any work. So this is information that has come between the, since the Proactive Finance Committee meeting and today. In speaking with the USDA folks, the loan that they would finance for us would be everything from that phase two on for any of the monies that we need for that. So that means that in addition to a USDA loan, we would probably end up with the additional for phase one and for the RSA money that was used from Del Norte County Loan Fund. We will need to find other funding for that, which we do have someone working on. But for the USDA portion alone, the pre-application is already in process. A lot of documents have been sent to them. We're working with Roy Ashby of the Ashby Adams Group in Sacramento. She was came recommended to us by the City of Crescent City. And what we need at this point is a co-applicant, because BACRA does not have the financial resources to be guaranteeing those payments. And so that's where we come to you today, asking for you to take on a co-applicant status on this.
Great. Thank you, Susan. Any questions from board members? Roger.
Boy, these numbers are flying around. I'm trying to make some sense out of this. Yeah, I know. And so the applicant, the co-applicant is Del Norte County. Is that my understanding?
That's what we're asking.
You're asking
for,
us
yes.
to take on this. So let me see if I got the numbers correct here. Whether or not Oregon comes through in August or not, there's going to be a total amount of encumbrance of $3 million, in excess of $3 million. Is that correct? Of which Oregon might pay some, $6,584. And that encumbrance might be $2,450,000. Is that correct?
If the ODOT grant does come through, it would be at 2.4 total. If it does not come through, it would be at the $3
million. $3,034,000 and some change. Okay,
correct.
So what's the plan? Give me a payment, a 360-month, 30-year amortization. Interest rates, I didn't see it on there. What's the plan to pay this money back, so that Del Norte County is not vulnerable over the next 30 years in case you can't pay it back, and then we have to absorb this?
Okay, the interest rate that's used on the loan repayment, see at the top it says 4%. So that was the amount that was used. And as basically a staff member of BACRA, what I can tell you is that we would need to have our members make payments, and we don't have any guarantees at this time. We are asking the county to take this on as the landowners and as the Delaware County Airport, knowing and fully feeling that every member should be making a contribution towards this. What we have faced every time we go into a presentation with our members, they want someone else to move first. They want to know what the County of Del Norte is going to do. And so we're kind of between a rock and a hard place. And we don't have, and I cannot give you, something that tells you that we are going to be able to keep Del Norte County from ever having to assume these payments. In all actuality, Del Norte County will certainly have a portion of it. All we can do is keep working to make sure that's the smallest portion that we can manage.
Is this a fully amortized loan? Is this 360 months, that's 30 years, or in the case of 40 years, is this paid monthly? So we're closing down the balance. How are you structuring this? It's lump sum of $2,208,000 or $168,000 or $140,000 or $122,000. Was it a yearly payment, a bi-month, bi-yearly? What, how do we pay it back?
Okay, we are just starting the process with the USDA, and so I don't have all of those numbers for you yet. What we're asking today is that you go in on a pre-application. You're not signing documents that say, you know, you're not putting your name on anything that says we are making these payments tomorrow. You are going in on a pre-application. Any loan documents will be coming back to you. The details will be coming back to you. And so you'll have another chance to take a look at it before anything moves forward. So this was just a straight amortization, and it was based on monthly payments. And so this is definitely, you know, a rounding of it.
Just a closing comment, I'd like to have this run by our auditor, Clinton Shad, because this has to be budgeted. If we're on the hook to do this, and loan this money, we have to have an end game plan. What if happens? So has the auditor seen this?
He has been in a meeting with us and with other county staff. He was not able to make the proactive financial committee meeting. He did, however, receive all the documentation.
Yes, Supervisor McClure.
You know, when you get big numbers like this, it kind of makes you suck air because you understand what the budget is and how tight it is. But I also think, and this is because I think that you hit the nail on the head when you said that the other partners will step up after. And so it truly is just, this application is kind of a Hail Mary pass that, because we will have an option to back out of it if we don't have, if we can't budget, if all of a sudden we're on the hook for $208,000 a year, it's probably, I don't know if we can reach that far. But I don't think we're gonna be on that hook. I think that the partnerships have been together long enough, and I think that, you know, it's a hiccup with the Oregon Department of Transportation, but the airport improvement grants and money that has come to our community over the years is millions and we might even be over the $1 billion mark. And so it's an economic driver that we need to make sure we put our head around, but we also can't put our little budget into a deep hole. But I think that I would encourage the board to say, yes, we should sign on, knowing that there are options, there are times that we can still back out if it doesn't pencil, but we have to get it rolling because the application process is so robust. So that would be my position. Thank you.
Thank you. Supervisor Howard.
This board, along with many other boards in this community, set in motion goals a decade ago with HAS199.com. Goals that if we build our infrastructure, we will reap those awards. We need to stay on track. And more importantly, when you look at it in the big picture, us leveraging 95% of this larger budget for this terminal, to me, you know, that's a leap of faith at this point I'm willing to make in an application process. We haven't said yes yet, but we have a process in place to put our name on an application in support of the county's mission along with our other partners in HAS199.com.
Thank you. David, anything?
Yeah, I think, you know, not to try to reiterate too much what's been said, it's a $20 million project. $17 million's coming from the federal government. That's economic development. So we're looking at that worst-case scenario of $3 million amortized over the 30 or 40 years. Number one. Number two, you're exactly right, has 199.com, the community weighed in, we needed to do it. The genius, if I might take a little bit of headlines here, is with establishing the Border Coast Regional Airport Authority, knowing full well that the responsibility of that airport was solely with the county and our community development. We recognize that half the users were regional in nature, coming from Oregon, and so we formed that JPA with two of the sovereign nations, two states, two cities, and two counties. Never been done before. And part of it was to get buy-in from the entire community to lessen the responsibility or the financial debt on the county. This is simply the next step, a required step in an application process. Going forward, Oregon has already demonstrated its ability to help us out. They already helped us out with several hundred thousand dollars, and now they're still going back to the drawing board. Elk Valley Rancheria has stepped up to the plate and prepaid some of their loans. They put in over $100,000, and the county puts in theirs, and the city puts in theirs. Okay, there's absolutely no reason to try and, I know the devil's advocates are out there, and they have to be out there because it's part of the necessary process. But let's keep our eye on the prize and look at how positive this is. The worst case scenario for this community would be that the county had to shoulder it themselves. We have done the homework, done the politicizing, gone for legislative benefits, pleaded with the FAA, got the funding, and put the wheels in motion to allow for this community as a whole to be successful and to spread the cost over the entire community. Can't stop the naysayers, but I urge us all to stay on that positive track.
Yes, thank you. And I have to certainly agree with that. We are an airport without borders, whether that's the border between Oregon and California or between the sovereign nations. So it is a community effort. We are asked to pay a very small portion of a very large number, and that money will be spent in Delmar County one way or another. So as David said, it is economic development. It's, you know, we're basically out of options. We can't let that go, in my opinion. So anyway, moving along, I need a motion.
Yeah, I just move to,
I'm taking care of that.
So I would move to approve and authorize the County of Delmar to be the co-applicant status for USDA loan application to support construction of the terminal project as requested by the program manager of the Border Coast Regional Airport Authority.
Second that motion.
Okay, any public comment?
You know what? $17 million is a lot of money. Economic development is highly important for our area, but...
Could you identify yourself?
Linda Sutter, 5th District. But keep in mind that most construction projects such as this, they come out, you need to add 20% more to that price tag, okay? What services are we going to cut if we can't afford this? Are you willing to cut services? Police department, sheriff's department, welfare department. Where's the money going to come from? Who's going to be paying for this? I mean, I know the county's going to be paying for it. That means the people, the taxpayers, are going to be paying for it. What liability is involved with that? It's just something to look at. You know, I want that shiny new Terminal 2. It's a shiny carrot that's dangled before some monkeys, and we want to grab it. but you better take into consideration that we are going to be the ones paying for it, and only us. You can't count on ODOT. Crescent City, you can't count on, because they're already strapped. $20,000 for 5 years for the RSA is all they can afford. They can't afford this terminal. The Elk Valley, they haven't committed to it. City of Brookings, they don't want to until somebody else jumps in. So we're the only ones. We're the only ones. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment?
How many passengers do you have that warrant a 17 million, 20 million? And where are all these jobs that are going to... It's like you put the cart before the horse every time. You're building the airport. You don't even have passengers.
Thank you. Any other public comment?
Eileen Cooper, this might be an afterthought, but I would hope when we look at building buildings these days, we should try to implement as much energy saving strategy as possible. And I don't know to what degree we've analyze that with this building, but I would hope there would be, since we're just at looking at allocating money and where we can save, I think this community is going to have to maintain this building and heating bills and etc. So it's to our benefit to make sure it's as green as possible. I know we're kind of stuck with the long orientation. I'm glad to see a lot of energy catching windows on the west side, but I can't help thinking that that big sloping roof to the east couldn't be made more energy conscientious by trapping heat when we need it. So I just would like the architects to see where we can save money in the future for maintenance so that our ongoing costs are reduced as much as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Okay, seeing no other public comment, then I'm going to close the public comment on this item and bring it back to the board. Any further comments or questions, Roger?
I just want a clarification. There is, in fact, an opt-out process if the worst-case scenario develops. Can you just address that one question only? That we're gonna put our signature on this loan, but I've heard that from Supervisor Howard, there is an opt-out process. Is that correct?
You would put your signature on a loan application. And so then there's a second opt-out occasion before you sign the actual document. We would come back to you with that.
Any other questions or comments from board members? Okay, Kylie, would you please pull the vote?
Supervisor McClure?
Yes.
Supervisor Gitlin?
Yes.
Supervisor Finnegan?
Yes.
Supervisor Howard?
Yes.
Chair Hemmingson?
Yes. Okay, moving along. Dave, thank you for your patience. Dave, thank you so much. I apologize, we're running a little bit behind time. Going to give us an update on our Smith River National Recreation Area.
Oh, definitely. Dave Palmer, District Ranger, Smith River National Recreation Area. So, like the... thank the board for the opportunity to come down again. I've only got a couple updates since my last visit. One has to do with travel management. I spoke to you last time, you know, we're gearing that up, ramping up the team to get that going again, and come to find out yesterday that they plan to have the final EIS and the draft record of decision out in July. So, if we can keep that timeline going, that'll be great. That'll, I think once it gets into the Federal Register, that starts the 45-day objection review process, and so that would end up in September. So that's gonna let me shift a lot of my staff folks to working with the Smith River Collaborative. You know, I'd like to thank Supervisor Hemmingson and Grant Orskull of the Smith River Alliance for heading that up and getting that going. It's going to, you know, provide a lot of benefit, I think, to the community, especially with my staff, you know, working with the collaborative to plan and implement projects that the community wants. So look forward to that. Just see a couple other things is that, you know, we've got all of our seasonal workforce up. So we've got all of our fire folks. They're already trying to grab them to go work on the southern Sierra Nevadas with all the tree mortality. So that could be, you know, pretty busy season down there. Hopefully we're quiet up here. I've got my rec staff. They're out there working, cleaning up the campgrounds, working on the water system at Grassy Flat. So we're going to have Grassy Flat open this year. So we'll be up and running hopefully by the end of the month. With the weather changing, we're going to be looking at opening all of our gates, getting our roads cleaned up, getting all the rocks off. So hopefully by Memorial Day weekend, we're up and running 100%. Other than that, that's all I had this time around.
Great, Dave. Thank you. I appreciate that. So now I can let that air out that I've been holding my breath on the travel management and take another breath, and we'll wait till...
We keep promising dates, but, you know, Merv wants this done.
So. I know, and I appreciate it, and I appreciate Merv. I think you guys are both doing an excellent job, and appreciate the ability to have a conduit or a communication corridor that we can speak through, so appreciate it. Any questions or comments from board members? David?
Dave, you hit something there that a lot of people aren't aware of, is they're already talking about this could be the worst fire season ever. And the reason is because of the bark beetle infestation in the Sierras. Are you going to be able to maintain a staff to keep our forest open here?
Fire-wise, it's going to be hit and miss because the regional forester and the chief has made all the Sierra Nevada, the southern Sierra Nevada and all the some like 40 million dead trees a priority. So they're already calling for groups to go down there to extents. I would suspect as the fire season goes, they're gonna kind of have to even that out, so we do have coverage throughout the state. My rec staff will be here, so yep, we will be up and running. Might be short on fire, but I think we'll be doing pretty good.
Thanks. Anything else? Anybody got any comments, questions? Dave, thank you so much. I appreciate it. Please come back.
Oh, you bet. And, you know, I did forget one thing. I think we're up and ready to go with all the trail work for the summer. So look forward to all the youth crews that are going to come work on our trails and prove them and get them laid out again.
Great.
So,
thanks again.
Thank you.
Any public comment on this presentation? Okay. Moving right along. We're going to take up the consent agenda.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes?
I'd like to pull item number 13 for discussion on consent.
Okay. So can I get a motion on all items except for item number 13?
Move to approve all items except for item number 13.
Okay, I have a motion for the consent agenda on items excluding item number 13. That's 1 through 15. Can I get a second?
A second.
I have a motion and a second. Any public comment on the consent agenda only minus item number 13? Okay, seeing no public comment then, I will bring it back to the board. Comments or questions? Seeing no comments from the board, Kylie, would you poll the vote, please?
Supervisor Finnegan?
Yes.
Supervisor McClure?
Yes.
Supervisor Gitlin?
Yes.
Supervisor Howard?
Yes.
Chair Hemmingson?
Yes. And within that consent agenda, there were a couple of proclamations. The proclamation claiming May 2016 as Mental Health Month. Supervisor Gitlin, Would you please read?
Do I have that? I'm sorry.
Oh,
okay.
I'm sorry. Did I leave?
What a cold read. Okay.
I'm sorry. He was on the mental health board, so I meant to give it to you, Roger.
Thank you very much, Chairman. All right. This is a proclamation of Mental Health Month for May of 2016, whereas optimal mental health care is essential to the overall health of the Del Norte County, resulting in productive activities, fulfilling relationships, and the ability to adapt to change and cope with adversity, and whereas an estimated 26% of American adults ages 18 and over, about 1 in 4 American adults, are affected by mental illness, and our local mental health board and other agencies emphasize the importance of promoting mental health and the early identification of mental illness, and whereas mental health problems do not discriminate, they affect people regardless of race, creed, age, lifestyle, or economic status, and mental health recovery is possible with proper treatment and support, empowering mental health consumers to lead full and productive lives, and whereas as many as 8 million Americans who have serious mental health issues do not receive adequate treatment each year, and people who have untreated mental health issues use more general health services than those who receive mental health services when they need them, and whereas nearly 40,000 people in the United States die from suicide annually, or one person every 13 minutes, and the County of Del Norte has made a commitment to mental health care in which all residents can receive high-quality and consumer-centered services and take pride in the history of upholding the dignity and civil rights of all its people, including those coping with mental illness, and whereas mental health should not be shrouded in stigma and discrimination, causing those who are affected to not seek care, the County of Del Norte observes Mental Health Month every May to raise awareness and understanding of mental health, and whereas we recommend the Department of Health and Human Services, Mental Health Branch, and all the community partner organizations, whether private, faith-based, or governmental, and individuals for their outstanding work improving the quality of life for mentally ill disabled individuals in our community. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Supervisors, by the County of Del Norte, in May of 2016 is hereby proclaimed as Mental Health Month throughout Del Norte County, and calls upon its citizens, government agencies, public and private institutions, businesses, and schools to recommit our community to increasing awareness and understanding of mental illness and the need for appropriate and accessible services for all people with mental illness. Passed and adopted this 10th day of May, 2016, signed by Chairman Jerry Hemmingson. And I can see, John, you're here, so I'll walk around.
Thank you, Mr. Gitlin. I want to thank Mr. Gitlin and the rest of the board, and all the people that help take care of us and help us see us have more expanded lives. Thank you. This is this day, May 16. Thanks.
Thank you.
I just want to hand out the.
Okay. Thank you all for coming. Now we have another proclamation. Supervisor McClure will read.
Thank you. I have the honor of proclaiming Foster Parent Appreciation during the National Foster Care Month, May 2016. Whereas the family serves as the primary source of love and identity, self-esteem, and support, and it is the very foundation of our communities and our county. And whereas in Del Norte County, there are 87 children in youth and foster care who deserve the best opportunities that we can provide, as well as safe, secure, and stable housing, and possesses the compassion and nurtures for the foster family. Whereas all children and youth in foster care need a positive, meaningful connection to a caring adult who becomes supportive and lasting presence in their lives. And whereas dedicated foster families help fulfill the vital role of providing guidance, stability, and love, and which helps children and families heal and reconnect, resulting in the launching of young people into successful adulthood. And whereas dedicated families frequently adopt foster children, resulting in a continuous greater need for more
but that result is a continuous greater need for more foster families. And whereas there are countless individuals, public and private organizations, and often the often unsung heroes who work to increase public awareness of the needs of the children and that are living in foster care. And whereas all the enduring and valuable contributions of foster parents, kinship, adoptive homes, the foster care system is only as good as those who choose to be part of it. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Del Mar County Board of Supervisors hereby proclaim Foster Parent Appreciation during National Foster Care Month of May 2016 in Del Mar County and urge all citizens to join us in helping to change a lifetime for a child or youth in foster care by volunteering their talents and energies on behalf of children in foster care, foster parents, and child welfare, and all other committed professional staff working with them this month and throughout the year. Passed and adopted by the Board of Supervisors, Del Mar County, State of California, this 10th day of May by the unanimously poll vote.
I'd just like to say that we really appreciate the job that foster care providers do in our community, along with also the relative care providers and the non-related extended family members that provide care. We are accepting on their behalf today. We had a last minute change, so thank you so much to the board for making the proclamation. Thank you.
Great. Thanks to all of them. Okay, item number 13, Supervisor Gitlin.
I did bring it up. Heather, are you in the audience? Okay. And let me speak in terms of, I think this is a wonderful program. It's a great program, but I just need to read this. And you and I have had this conversation before, and you're kind of take the brunt because you're the newbie. And also, we are directorless at this exact moment. But I'm looking at the dates of this Child Health and Disability Prevention Certification Program. July 1st, 2015. That means we are 10 months into this program, which incidentally expires next month, June 2016. $287,835 is requested by Assistant Director of Health and Human Services. 10 months later, we're voting on this thing to approve it. It's almost over. What can we do to get these items to us in a timely way? So perhaps we can make a suggestion, we can even enhance it. I don't know, maybe there's an ability to find even more money to do this kind of worthwhile work. We're seeing this all too often, where we're seeing things that come to us six months, 8 months. This one's 10 months after the fact. Do we have common ground here?
Thank you for your question. As I understand, the question is not with the content of this number, but with the timeline and maybe in general a bigger issue. So I think there's some special circumstances for the timeline of this issue that maybe have brought it late in the past and maybe would continue to do that next year. And if you'd like more information on this item's timeline specifically, I have back up here Melody from Public Health. But in general, your statement is taken, and I will take that into account and bring items more timely so that the board can be more proactive. So in general, I understand. And specifically, would you like more information about this timeline?
No, I think the program's a great program.
Okay.
It's just this board is relegated to a status of a rubber stamp. It's going to be expired. Money is already spent, and well spent. But this isn't just a standalone event. This happens a great deal with the Department of Health and Human Services. It's been going on a long time. I don't know if it's a Sacramento problem, but can someone write a letter? Can someone do an intervention so that we can get these things in front of our eyes in a more timely manner? That would be my request.
Again, this is a separate individual situation that has some special circumstances, and I do take your point in general, and we'll do what we can to get things to you more timely.
And on that motion, I'll make the motion to approve the funding for $287,835.
I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any public comment? Okay, seeing no public comment. Any further discussion from the board?
Yes. I would like to hear the story of why it's held up, because you anticipate that this will happen again in the next year's budget cycle also.
My understanding is it hasn't.
Because of how it's set up.
Yes.
so Melody can help us out.
Yes, Supervisor McClure would like to hear the specifics of this item as to why it is...
Tell the story of why it's going to do this again next year also.
So unlike most of my contracts in public health...
If you could speak into the microphone.
I'm sorry. This contract is a three-program package, and each program has its own separate allocation. These allocations are released to us so that we can know how much money that we'll have for that fiscal year. They're released to us separately, and the last one is usually issued in October of the current fiscal year. So we cannot even begin our budgeting process. The contract starts July 1st. We don't even know about our allocations until October. So this is a fairly complex package of MOUs, scope of work, performance measures, and these are all issued to us, and we have to report them on templates that the state provides to us. All of those things have to be in place for us to be able to complete the package and then submit it to you for approval. We shoot for December after getting our allocation letters. Sometimes it's January, February. This year, we actually had an issue, though, with the final sign-off process in order to bring it before you, and it was due to staff availability to sign off. We'll do our very best to make sure that we're more timely in the future, and this particular problem should not repeat itself.
Thank you very much for the explanation. Anything else? Kylie, would you poll the vote, please?
Supervisor Howard?
Yes.
Supervisor McClure?
Yes.
Supervisor Gitlin?
Yes.
Supervisor Finnegan?
Yes.
Chair Hemmingson?
Yes. Okay, moving on to general government, item number 21. We have a bid package for the Klamath Macbeth Field for some planned obstruction removal.
Okay, hello again. As you said, Mr. Chairman, this is concerning an obstruction clearance project at Klamath Macbeth Field. This was explicitly cited during our last inspection by Caltrans. The plan specifications and engineering estimate were prepared by the County of Del Norte. Prior to that, it went before the Environmental Review Committee, and a notice of exemption was granted for this project. I believe it's an encore. I think we did this about 15 years ago, but I'd have to check with our airport archivist. This will be the trees and brush between the river and runway 11, just to the southwest of the airport there. So what I'm asking you today is to authorize the chair to sign the bid package and direct staff to begin the process for the planned obstruction removal project at Klamath Macbeth Field, and this is a $30,000 grant.
Thank you.
Move to approve and authorize the chair to sign the bid package and direct staff to begin the bid process for the planned obstruction removal clearance.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any public comment on this item?
At Macbeth Field.
Any public comment on this item? Seeing no public comment.
I wanted to know if the covenant was still on the airport from the pesticides that were sprayed.
This is on Macbeth Field? In Klamath?
On Klamath.
Okay, any other public comment? Seeing no other public comment, then we'll bring it back to the board. Any further discussion? Kylie, would you please poll the vote?
Supervisor Gitlin?
Yes.
Supervisor McClure?
Yes.
Supervisor Finnegan?
Yes.
Supervisor Howard?
Yes.
Chair Hemmingson?
Yes. Okay, we're going to take up item number 24 on the agenda. Has to do with the solid waste, and I don't know how many First Amendments to the solid waste JPA we can have, but this is another first one, is it, Ted?
Chairman Hemmingson, fellow members of the supervisor, staff, members of the public, my name's Ted Ward. I'm director of the Del Norte Solid Waste Management Authority. Item 24 before you is to approve the second amended joint powers agreement. Our legal counsel suggested that it would be more coherent just to put them all in one document so we could read them all. So this is the second amended joint powers agreement, making the changes that were discussed at a previous Board of Supervisors meeting and also discussed by the City Council. The three changes that are made based on the advisory votes of the City Council and Board of Supervisors is first, how the authority's annual budget is approved, which would be essentially the recommendation, and the one incorporated into the second amended joint powers agreement would be that it would be at the option of the CAO and the city manager in consultation with the chairs of their respective boards as to whether or not to place the approval of the authority's budget on their agenda, but that certainly would be their annual discretionary action to do so. Currently, of course, it's a requirement, and that's another thing we'll be talking about today. The second issue is with respect to how the authority's public commissioner is appointed and approved, and the consensus from the City Council and a majority vote of the Board of Supervisors would be that the public commissioner of the authority would be appointed for 2 years and would not be subject to approval or removal by the Board of Supervisors or City Council. And the third issue was how the authority's ordinances are approved, and again, a consensus of the City Council and a majority vote of the Board of Supervisors suggested that our JPA be modified so that authority ordinances other than rate ordinances must be approved separately by the Board of Supervisors and the City Council before final adoption by the authority board. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay. Questions from board members? I have a few things that need to be addressed. On page 3, the whereas at the top of the page, that those three paragraphs I think should be deleted. I don't see a need for any of that. So I think we just need to take that out. There's no substance basically to it that needs to be in an amendment. On page number 10, under B, you have our county administrative officer as the county chief administrative officer, so we need to remove the word chief. He is just the county administrative officer. And then item D, I think, should be removed completely also.
Item 10D, you said?
7D.
7D.
D.
B, as in boy?
It has to do with comments on the budget, where you put in there page number 10. It has to do with comments on the budget, that if a person who had comments on the budget doesn't show up to a meeting, that those comments are just retracted. I don't think there's any kind of a need for that, and I don't know, you know, it's kind of like you have to be present to win.
Well, the challenge, and I believe the reason why it was structured that way, and is that oftentimes comments have been offered from the dais, mm-hmm. and the challenge is then it would be my obligation to try to communicate it to our authority board, the specific comments from either the City Council or the Board of Supervisors. Without a person present or those comments being provided in writing, I want to make sure that I'm following through on the intent of those respective bodies as best I can, and that's the reason why an individual is requested to make a presentation to the authority board so they can have that discussion.
Well, I think you should address the comments. I don't have a problem with that, but I don't think that necessarily that they should be blindly retracted just because that person is not able to show up at that particular meeting. So I don't think there's a need for it. Make your comments. You can address those comments or not. I mean, there's no obligation on your part basically to do anything with those comments as far as I can see, and never has been. So I don't know why we would put D in there retracting comments just because a person doesn't show up. Doesn't necessarily mean that his comments aren't valid, but you're all of a sudden saying he doesn't show up, so those comments are retracted and they should just go away, and I don't think that's the case. And that's all I had.
Can you go back to your first one and explain what that was?
The first one is
whereas.
It's just the whereas, the, you know, that it's on page 3, I believe. Yeah, there just doesn't seem to be. County Council and I have talked about this. There just doesn't seem to be a reason to have it in an amendment. I mean, those items are in. That we've talked about, they're in the agreement. Why do we have to have a heading that says we have a whereas and a therefore.
I can't find it.
Here.
I can't, it's not cooperating with me. I have a question with County Council that this is an amendment before a JPA amendment that's still lingering because, well, any amendment is going to have to come in front of the Board of Supervisors except for the adoption of the ordinance. But now there have been suggested changes that I have not prepared for as a member of the Solid Waste Board. So I don't know what those changes are, and we're amending the JPA on this. So I didn't realize that we had the power to amend a JPA from the dais.
The agreement would need to be signed by all the member agencies like any other JPA, if that makes sense.
Yes, that makes sense, but usually the JPA itself, if it's doing an amendment, we can take the recommendations that have been just made, but I can't support removing things from a JPA if I haven't had the time to remove them, and our thing today is to adopt two ordinances, so I guess that I would have to ask that
to be tabled.
Is this, and I don't know what the sequence of events in relationship to tabling, but it seems that it's an added action that wasn't agendized.
I mean, I think if those are the comments or the suggestions that that they can either be, that's the board recommendation, if that is the entire board's recommendation, the board could ask that that be taken back for staff to review or for Solid Waste to review.
So I think, which whereas, because this only has these two whereas.
This whereas.
I thought you said there were three of them.
There's three things that I want removed.
I'm not good at doing stuff on the fly.
Well, what would be possible if this is the consensus of the Board of Supervisors and the way that you would all like to go, is we could make these changes and present them to the City Council, and if the City Council accepted them, then we would have both approval from the City Council and the Board of Supervisors, and then that could be brought back to the Authority Board. If that doesn't violate the process where it would have to start with the Authority Board.
Yes. I'm not, because it's the two member agencies, I believe if both member agencies signed that is adequate, but procedurally, if it's preferable to go back to the board first, then that could happen, or you know, this recommendation from the board could happen first, then it could go back to the Solid Waste Board, then back to the city. I believe the amendments are fairly minor, aside from the D section. Regarding the comments, but it would be functionally the same, I believe. Whereas that Mr. Supervisor Hemmingson is talking about isn't really a make or break thing. It's just, as far as a legal review, I don't think it really makes any difference. And then the title change on the county administrative officer is, of course, pretty minor. So it's that D section.
I think I'm asking a bigger process question. That if you have a JPA, and if there are two boards of the JPA, and they decide, those two boards, separate from the JPA having a public discussion about it, make changes in the JPA, it seems to me that the JPA should be the origin of changes that come forward, that the process is set up that way, that otherwise you could have boards, it doesn't make sense to me. And that's my question, is the process question, is that you have a joint powers authority agreement on how you operate, and to amend that agreement, should the amendment process start at the JPA board, or do the oversight boards that have joined this JPA, can they start managing the JPA from that level?
So I think we'd have to look specifically, and Mr. Ward might be more familiar with the amendment section. Generally it does come from that board itself, such as Tri-Agency or Solid Waste. And that board recommends changes, which I believe did happen in this case in reaction to some of the things that had been said by some of the boards. The signatories are the City of Crescent City and this board. So I do believe that process-wise, as far as unless there's something specific in the agreement that I haven't seen, that with both those signatory approvals that it could be changed. I believe in this case it has been started from the Solid Waste Board itself. But if it's preferable to send it back to them for approval of those changes first, I think that's something you could do as well. But I believe both with this process started, if there are those minor changes that both parties are signing off of, it should be legally valid anyway. And I don't know if Mr. Ward wants to weigh in on the amendment process, since he's been a little bit more intimately involved with that.
I think either one could work. I certainly acknowledge Supervisor McClure's concerns that this has changed. It hasn't been discussed with the authority board. And so if this is the consensus of the Board of Supervisors, it seems as deference to the chair of the Solid Waste Authority Board, I should bring it back to the authority board first before it goes to the city.
Yeah, whatever's easiest. I mean, we certainly can't have our county administrative officer have a wrong title.
I appreciate that.
I mean, that's pretty obvious. And I think the item number D, 7D, is, I think I've explained it fairly well, that I don't think you can just dismiss a comment just because somebody doesn't show up. So if you have a comment from somebody and you're going to address that to your board, but that person's not there, and then so you don't make a comment to it at all, it's like, oh, the person didn't show up, so I'm not even going to make that comment. I don't think that's right. So I'm just saying, I don't think just because somebody doesn't show up at the meeting after they have made a comment, I think that comment needs to be addressed. Doesn't necessarily have to agree with the comment, but you have to address the comment regardless of whether that person shows up. That's my opinion. It's just unimportant. It just doesn't need to be there. Whether it's there or not there is not going to break my heart. It just doesn't need to be there, in my opinion.
I have no problem. The points you're making are taken. I'm minus a process point. Minus a process.
Yeah, and that's point. And I don't care how you do it. It doesn't make any difference to me. It could come back.
Because I don't disagree with those, but I'm just saying process.
Whatever your process is fine. If you want to take
with deference to the this board, I would ask that you allow this to be taken back to the Solid Waste Authority for approval with the recommendations as presented by Chairman Hemmingson.
Okay, that's a motion?
No, that's an ask for the request to table.
Okay. Request to table. Do I have a second to request
that? Second that motion to table.
Okay. Any public comment? Okay, seeing the public comment, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carries unanimously.
Thank you.
No problem.
I'm just kind of a process.
So,
walk.
Now, unfortunately.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
I'm fully understanding why some of these solid waste meetings that I do not participate in have taken so long in the history of that esteemed organization. Perhaps after it goes to solid waste, and then rather having it come back to the county and to the city separately, we have a joint meeting so we don't go this merry-go-round for the next 6, 8, 10, 12 months.
Okay. Although that could take 6 or 10 or 12 months. So, you know, however you want to do it, it doesn't matter. I just think those are changes that need to be made. However you do it and bring it back to us, if you decide not to make those changes, then I would have a different opinion on whether I would be in favor of it, is all. But I think there are things that can be changed without impacting the agreement.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Just so we're clear on this, we've tabled 24, which means the First Amendment to the Del Norte Solid Waste Management Authority Joint Powers Agreement will not be held today. It'll be at a future meeting. Probably, is it the next meeting you're planning on putting this on the agenda, Mr. Chairman?
I'll put it on the agenda when it comes back to us.
Okay.
And
because
there are some issues
with regard to the amendment changes that I'd like to comment, but I'm going to reserve my comments until it comes back on the agenda.
You might want to make some comments at the Solid Waste Authority meeting so they can address those comments before it comes back, because this could be a revolving door.
This board is going to vote on approving the First Amendment. It'll be an up or down, yes or no vote, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm comfortable with that. Whether I need to go to a solid waste meeting, which I think conflicts with my existing schedule of other meetings,
okay.
I don't know if I need to do that. I just want to make sure what we're doing now is tabling it, and then we'll come back and we'll take a vote on whether we approve and authorize the First Amendment to the Del Norte Solid Waste Management Authority Joint Powers Agreement or not.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Okay, item number 22, which if we would have passed item number 24, I wouldn't think we would have to deal with those, but I could be wrong.
This is just, it's another one of those process things. In order to do the amendment, it takes time for it to go through the system, and so Eli is still on the old amendment prior to approval, and we're requesting that he be put on the board, and it needs board approval. Because it came before the amendment, we had to follow the current JPA status, and that's what the next two do.
Okay. So, the next item is to approve the appointment of Mr. Naffa.
Motion to approve the appointment of Eli Naffa
as
the public commissioner for the Del Norte Solid Waste Management Authority, April 2018, as requested by the director, Del Norte Solid Waste Management Authority.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any public comment? Seeing no public comment, then I'll bring it back to the board. Any comment? Do we need a poll vote?
I don't believe so for this one.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carries unanimously. Moving on to item number 23, Solid Waste Authority budget. And I didn't think we were going to have to do this either, so I thought we'd agreed that we wouldn't, but that's another process thing, I guess.
It is.
If it all gets approved next year, we won't have to do this. But I will try to skip to the main points. We have a brief PowerPoint presentation. So this is the presentation regarding the budget for the authority for fiscal year 2016-2017. There we go. Summary of some of the responsibilities of the authority, namely operating transfer stations in Del Norte County Transfer Station, Gasky, and Klamath, and as well as taking responsibility for the Crescent City landfill and reports accordingly, planning for recycling. Even with this budget change, we still remain having the lowest rates in the region. This budget process includes review by the Board of Supervisors today, review by the City Council on May 16th. CPI, consumer price index-based rate adjustments have been included in all the budget projections, and this budget also includes updated cost projections from the Del Norte County Auditor, including revised payroll expenses based on recent union negotiations and an increase in the interfund cost plan of over $10,000 since last year. And if all goes according to the schedule, then the final budget will be approved on June 21st. Here's the staffing chart currently for the authority. Thinking about the budget as a whole, this is a report from fiscal year 14-15, because of course these reports are after the fact, but it shows you that of the solid waste dollars spent in Del Norte County, 57% of those approximately go to Recology Del Norte, 25% go to Hambro WSG, and the Solid Waste Authority staff and its activities cover 18% of the budget. But all of those are the responsibility of the Solid Waste Authority budget. That's the reason for the orange plate below it all. Looking at the Solid Waste Authority budget for the fiscal year, you can see that approximately two-thirds of the expenses are for Hambro WSG to do the transfer station operations and disposal. Authority service fees are approximately one-third of the revenue. We also receive franchise fees from Recology Del Norte, and then there's a small fraction for grants and other sources of revenue. Looking at our planned expenses, again, you can see approximately two-thirds of the expenses do go to pay Hambro WSG for transfer station operations, followed by salaries, transfer station loan payments, funded depreciation, the interfund cost plan for the first time is now more expensive than our permit fees, and household hazardous waste event well monitoring. You also have a detailed budget in your packet, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Supervisor Gitlin.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Mr. Ward, I'm looking at your portion of the pie. Could you put that
Which one? The up?
Yeah, the divvying up by the monies.
Yeah.
No, one more. I think it's, 18%. And I seem to remember a number lower than that in past years, 14%. And then 16%, and this year it's 18%. So why the increase in Del Norte Solid Waste Management Authority income, and at the expense of what Hambro? I think Hambro's represented pretty consistent. So Recology Del Norte, are they taking the less of the pie?
I thank you for that question, and it does show that you're carefully observing what happens, because what you're saying is correct. Last year, we indicated we were about approximately 14% of the pie, and I had just copied over the numbers that had been used previously. One of the things I noticed was that the franchise fees that are paid by Recology were included in Recology's slice of the pie, but those are actually revenues that come to the authority.
And to be clear, the franchise fees, not sorry to interrupt you, are approximately $12,000 from the county. And
they are not from the county. They are entirely from Recology Del Norte.
Okay.
As part of the collections contract, they're required to pay a portion in franchise fees, and projected for this coming year, it's $256,520. The Solid Waste Authority is not funded by a penny of taxes from the city or the county. It's entirely funded by user fees.
So on my own quick math, it's about $20,000 per month. 256 divided by 12.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's what my figures show in the past, and that seems to be consistent. Okay, thank you, sir.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions, board members? Okay, any public comment on that presentation for the budget? Bring it back to the board for a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion and a second. Kylie, would you poll the vote, please?
Supervisor Gitlin?
Yes.
Supervisor Finnegan?
Yes.
Supervisor Howard?
Yes.
Supervisor McClure?
Yes.
Chair Hemmingson?
Yes. Okay, we're going to take about 3 minutes for a break. I've had a request, so hang in there. We'll be back momentarily. Okay, thank you. We're going to move on to item number 25, which is to approve and authorize the chair to send a letter supporting the Delmort Resource Conservation's position in a letter that they sent to the State Water Resources Control Board regarding Senate Bill 88. I'm looking for a motion or a comment.
I'd make the motion to approve.
Okay, I have a motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any public comment? This is on Senate 25. This is on Senate Bill 88. Yes.
Number 25 for water conservation motions. I'd just like to point out that our Smith River aquifer is very vulnerable to droughts. We have had a blessed year with it being an El Nino year, and yet our rainfall was, you know, pretty average, not exorbitant. But it was just a short year ago that we didn't have any rain in the winter. And so I think that climate change isn't going to mean that there's not going to be an easy picnic for Delmar County. This aquifer of ours in the Smith River Plain is different than many in our nation. It's refreshed every year. That means it's very vulnerable to droughts. So I'm not commenting specifically on how we should deal with monitoring that, but it's not going to be a picnic with climate change. And you can ask some of the users, like Don Gillespie and his neighbors. The previous year, their wells were lower than they had ever seen. And so that was just from 1 year of no winter rainfall. So it's something that we're going to have to struggle with, I think, and keep an eye on as to what we want to do. We definitely don't want big users coming in without being monitored. All right, thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Okay, seeing no other public comment, we're going to bring it back to the board.
Chair, if I may comment on some of the comments, I want there to be clear difference between a discussion of an aquifer, a discussion of surface water monitoring, and a discussion of groundwater monitoring. This is specifically a conversation about surface water monitoring, not about an aquifer in the Smith River. And I'd love to have Mr. Hooper address some of what we found in our research specific to an aquifer, if the time was prudent. However, to address surface water monitoring, it has been taking place here by legislative law for a very, very long period of time. What this letter addresses is specifically increasing the expenditures for many people in our community, not just municipalities, but also farmers and ranchers and folks that have water diversions, in the type of measuring device they put on that diversion. The data they have been reporting has been reported under state law since 2008, and that data is readily available online in the ERIMS database of the State Water Resource Control Board. But what we're trying to do here is save a massive expense to get more specified data during a time interval that may not make sense for an area that is not necessarily dependent, like the Central Valley or our southern friends. And so this addresses the concerns of our community, and this letter, I hope, serves to support the Resource Conservation District's opinion that these measuring devices are not necessarily the best step for expenditure dollars, limited dollars, for people in our community. But thank you for your comments. And I would ask Mr. Hooper, if you don't mind, Chair, to address some of the concerns or what we found data-wise with the Smith River aquifer year over year over year.
Well, and just to reiterate Supervisor Howard's point, there are two different issues. I think the recharge rates that we do see within the Smith River groundwater basin are probably some of the most resilient in the state. You do see spikes, you do see drops on a cyclical basis, but based on recharge and water production within the drainage itself and within the basin, again, you know, probably the most resilient groundwater basin in the state from that perspective.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions from supervisors? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Carries unanimously. Moving on to item number 26, approve and authorize the chair to send a letter opposing the outstanding national resource water designation on the Smith River North Coast to the North Coast Regional Water Quality Control Board.
I'd like to make that motion to approve and authorize the chair, Chairman Hemmingson, to send that letter opposing the outstanding national resource water designation, also known as ONRW, on the Smith at the North Coast to the North Coast Regional Water Quality Control Board. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I'd second that motion.
I have a second. Public comment?
Chance to speak with Chris Howard some of you. I have. I think this is very rash letter that closes the door on the very beginning of a process. You've gone from one extreme of not having any designation to from the whole river. There is a sweet spot in that range for us that is of benefit to this community. I think the legal advice in this proposal is very poor, incomplete. There is an anti-degradation policy for wild and scenic rivers or high quality waters, but there, as I was explained by the Water Board, what the value of this designation is that there is an anti-degradation loophole, and it's a very serious loophole. That states you get to degrade quality two waters if your use is of great importance. That sounds like strategic metals to me. And I don't want to see us vulnerable to that kind of fight and lawsuit when it comes to our precious river. I was told by the Forest Service in Oregon that they have depleted their budget fighting on this point, that when an area is closed to mineral exploration, like the National Recreation Area or other areas, that then there is this debate of, okay, well, you had an existing mine, but at the time we closed it, the value wasn't that great. All that has to happen is minerals skyrocket in value, like to $26 instead of $5 or $6 that it's at now, and we're in trouble. They have spent their money fighting. Well, we've proved there was so much concentration back so-and-so before you withdrew this area, so now the price shows that we have a valid claim. This can go to court, our river is vulnerable, and there's a sweet spot here. We need to protect that North Fork. We need to at least join hands with Oregon. And I'd like to see this community come together strong for something as precious as the Smith River. I never in my life dreamed that we would be able to accomplish this for the lower river, for the estuary, where we have all these diverse uses and people are going to be afraid of making permits more difficult. I don't think their permits are going to be more difficult. Personally, that's my opinion, because they already are meeting high quality water standards. So what more? For our everyday uses, we're not exempt.
Thank you.
So it's the mineral company that is exempt when it push comes to shove. So let's do the right thing here. All righty, thank you.
My name is Janet Gilbert, and I'm a county resident. I attended the presentation that the Water Quality Board put on April 26th, and the comments I heard were fears of the unknown, not obvious local impacts that you state in your letter. You state you have grave concerns in this designation. Please do you also recognize the more serious concerns of not achieving this designation? The Red Flat nickel mine claim is on hold for 2 years. Congressman Huffman's bill that he's trying to work through with the feds is a 5-year moratorium. It is not a complete exemption. We need the Smith River safeguarded in perpetuity. I ask you to consider writing instead a letter of inquiry instead of a letter of opposition. List your questions. You said that this presentation created more questions than answers, but it seems like you've already made up your mind. List your questions instead. Build bridges, not walls. Work with the process. Collaborate. See what you can do. I ask you to not make up your minds until you understand all the ramifications of this designation. I support this designation to protect this river and our economies in perpetuity, not just right now. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment?
Thank you, Don Olson, resident Hiuchi, on the banks of the Smith River. And I want to thank the board for this. The Smith River is presently one of the most governed and protected rivers in this state of California, let alone the country. And I applaud the board for wanting to seek clarity and greater understanding before buying into something that, and even though Eileen Cooper says we would have an out should we need one, once a regulation is in place and someone like the Friends wants to place a legal injunction against it, you're going to fight for years. And so I applaud you and I thank you for really looking into this more thoroughly for the benefit of the county.
Thanks, Don. Any other public comment? Okay, seeing no other public comment, then I'm going to bring it back to the board. Did we have a motion? Okay. Any other comments from board members? Yes, Martha.
I understand the frustration of and of the desire to want to protect the our drinking water in the Smith. And I think that earlier today we heard that we have until the 27th of May to weigh in on the mining proposal that's being that the environmental assessment is currently being done on, and I would really like to make sure that we weigh in on that the way we weighed in before. We don't want any mining up there, and so I think that's an opportunity to do this. I also think that this is an opportunity for the California Water Board to take a look at how they are going to apply these type of standards prior to a regional board getting a hold of it. And I think that there may be ups and downs and pluses and minuses, but the process of policy needs to happen at the California Water Board, not at the Northern California Regional Board, because this could replicate itself over the coast. So I would ask that the objection that we weigh in on the environmental assessment of the mining and ask that not be approved would be what I would like us to take as the next step, and then I could support sending this letter.
Supervisor Howard.
Just to address a few of the comments, the board's become very verse in this over the last several weeks. I don't think the decision that was made was taken lightly by any stretch of the imagination, and we did extensive amount of due diligence investigating what this meant for our community. And the problem is that our regional board could not define or describe a process. They admitted to that. And even in my conversations with their director, most recently as Thursday last week, he promised to us to do that very thing, which could take 3 to 4 months to describe and define a process, which gave us so much frustration in the conversation you heard at our last board meeting. But also taking that step back, which a lot of people in this community really believed needed to happen. We're not sure if this designation is the best tool. And right now we believe that designation was being used as a tool potentially to stop a mining operation on the North Fork of Smith River. That may be a good thing, that may be a bad thing, but I think this board has taken prudent steps right now to ensure that what was proposed by staff of the North Coast Board did not take a foothold for the entire basin, but necessarily looked at what it was intended for, which was a Friends of Delmar letter that addressed specifically the North Fork of the Smith in specifics to nickel mining.
Anybody else?
Well, there's a severe irony here because it really is about process. It's about something that isn't staff driven. It's about consultation and coordination with this Board of Supervisors that never happened, and that needs to happen. So we need to take a big step backwards to make sure that the will of the people is being adhered to, and the best way to do that is through the established process.
Supervisor Gitlin, anything?
Yes, thank you. The Smith River, as Mr. Olson said, is one of the cleanest in the world, and it's pristine. We have enough government in our community monitoring every movement we make to put another layer of bureaucracy on those who will now need a permit to do anything in and around the Smith River is punitive. To affect the possible affect the lily growers, it's punitive. It will hurt Delmar County. I don't look at this designation as some kind of a pat on the back from the Water Resource Board. I look at it as an opportunity for them to bring in their agenda, which ultimately, in my opinion, will hurt Delmar County. So with all due respect, this doesn't have anything to do with minerals. Quite the contrary, I don't think you'll see any contrary comment from anybody about nickel mining, or we're all resolute on that. But with regard to the Smith River, which is already one of the cleanest in the world and an example of how we are good stewards of this river, I can't support another layer of government coming in and telling us this is an honor and then begins to impose its agenda, which will affect Delmar County in a very negative way. So my motion stands, and I would ask that we pass this board, this letter to the State Water Resources Board. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to address the point of the nickel mine and the ONRW designation as two separate items. And we've weighed in on the strip mining, and I don't know why we can't use what we've already agreed on, why we can't send the letter that we've already approved, send that on as to whoever needs to have it on the issue of strip mining. The ONRW, in my opinion, is a whole different issue, and I think we need to keep these two things separate so they don't get commingled into something that we don't want them to be. We are totally against the strip mining. We've already voted on that, and I think that letter can be sent on. If I'm wrong, then now would be the time for County Council to tell me that I'm wrong, but I think we've already weighed in on that issue, and we should be able to send that on to whatever agency needs to have it. So I think we should do that, as well as sending this letter. So all those in favor of sending this letter opposing ONRW designation, signify by aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Carries unanimously. Okay, moving on. Legislative and budget issues. Jay, you got anything?
The board has acted a couple of times today on some of the legislative issues, but we are monitoring some bills out there. Right now it appears to be amend time on a lot of bills, and so some of those that started out one way are going to be ending up in a different, completely different realm. So it's constantly we're seeing those come through, and many of those will die because of that, but anything that is pertinent for us usually comes through RCRC or CSAC, or we get that through our legislators. And we're working on those, and we'll bring those to the board as need be, or work off the ledge platform. As far as our budget, we will begin meeting with departments next week, and we'll have meetings almost daily. We have yet to be able to go completely through the requested budget, but we will be doing that shortly before we go through there because it was submitted last Friday. But suffice to say, I'm sure there will be some questions inside of departments, whether it's revenue-related or expenditure-related, and then we will start working with them as the process goes. By the second meeting in June, we'll have a budget for spending authority before the board. It will likely be in the negative so that we can then see what happens with state revenues and hopefully not expenditures over the next couple of months and have a final. But we'll be working on that probably weekly now for the next several months.
Okay. Anybody have anything else? Okay. Nothing else? We are adjourned. Thank you all.